Well, good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. Sir, you want to move over there and stop bothering people? Open your Bible while we're goofing around this morning to Numbers chapter 13. This is a verse that Floyd brought up last week, and Julie and I were sitting over here, and he started talking about this, and she reaches over and cracks me in the ribs with her elbow like, "Are you guys conspiring?" I'm like, "No, we're not conspiring." Why? Because Friday night, before that Sunday morning, her and I were sitting at the house, and I asked her about this passage because the Lord had been stirring it up in me. And when Floyd started with it on Sunday, I was like, that's just like God, isn't it? Right? He is at work doing things. See, Floyd and I, we meet regularly, and we talk about what we feel that God's doing in us and revealing to us in the church in this season. And I find it very reassuring, personally, that as Floyd and I are both, we're spending time in the secret place, separate and apart from one another, that God is busy revealing his heart for us, for this church and for this city, in different ways and different times. He wants us to know what his heart is in this season, right? And we need to be attentive to it and listen and then respond. You know, David said that the people will perish for lack of vision, right? And this morning, God has been giving us, not just this morning, but God has been giving us his vision for this city and this church. And we're going to talk about stepping into and obeying that vision, okay? But I'm also happy to know that there are some of you here that have been listening to us talk about finding time in the secret place, and you're responding to that yourselves. You're having your own secret place time. You're hearing God's voice, and you're responding and obeying to what he said. That's part of the process, and that's so encouraging. I know that because you've told me. Some of you have come up to me and said, "Hey, I've been doing this thing like you guys said, and this is what's happening." I said, "Well, keep doing it." All right, that's what it's all about, this relationship with him so we can hear and understand. And before we go much further, I'm going to give a shout out to my friend Arlene. She's not feeling well this morning. She's home listening on Facebook. So, Arlene, we're praying for you. Hope you get better real quick. So let's go to Numbers 13 now. All right, you guys know this story. You're all biblical scholars, I'm sure. You're all hip up to speed on it. God commands Moses to send out spies to go see what the land is going to be like for them. Now, keep in mind that Israel has left Egypt. They are on the doorstep of the promised land. And God says, "Hey, send out some spies to go see what it's like so you know what you're going to be stepping into." And we all know the reports. 10 of the spies come back with this woe is us mindset. Oh my God, there's so much for us to go up against. The land is incredible and it would be perfect for us, but there's entirely too much to overcome. There are giants in the land, they said, and we're like grasshoppers in our own sight and in the sight of the descendants of Anak, who in biblical literature are literal giants. Too many things standing against us. We should just go back to Egypt, or I wish we had died on the way. Sounds kind of familiar to how believers go about their business as believers. There's too much against me to go out there and do something, or I don't know how. I'm afraid, I'm this, I'm that. But there were two spies who saw, hold on to that word because it's important, what God had envisioned for them, a land that was flowing with milk and honey. See, Caleb and Joshua recognized that God had made a declaration that Israel was to possess this land. It was going to be theirs and their descendants to occupy forever. Everything Caleb and Joshua had to say was in line and was responding to God's vision. You smell what I'm cooking? And what happened when Israel heard Joshua and Caleb's story, what their report was? The Bible says that those of Israel, the children of Israel, wanted to stone them. And go back to Egypt. And I think it's a grotesque understatement to say that God was frustrated with him. Right? So he spoke to Moses and said, all those who have complained shall perish along the way. They're on the doorstep of walking into the promised land. It's just too hard. You know people like that? Yeah, it's too much. It's too hard. I can't do it. But they're going to perish on the way. They will be carcasses in the wilderness is what it says. And that is some harsh words from God, right? But Caleb and Joshua are going to be blessed for believing and acting upon the vision and the declaration that God had made over Israel. And the spies who complained and grieved God died of the plague. And I kind of read it to mean it was almost immediate. And for every day they were spying the land, how many days did they spy the land? 40. Did you say that? Wow. Are you new to town? Oh, I thought maybe you were new to Fairbanks. I haven't seen you before. Come on, man. You know I love you. For every day they groused or that they spied the land, God added a year to their sentence, their punishment. 40 years they wandered in the desert until everyone 20 and over perished. Because they would not be allowed to enter into what God had promised them. Everyone 20 and under survives. So let's take a look at it. It's in Numbers 14, because this is kind of a long story. We're going to skip all of the people, each of the spies from the 12 tribes of Israel. We're going to go right to 14:3. This is their complaint. Why has the Lord brought us up to this land to fall by the sword? That our wives should become, wives and children should become victims. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? That's their complaint. All the children of Israel. But what's God's heart? When God speaks, he fulfills what he says he's going to do. Let's go to the next to 14:31. But your little ones, whom you said would be victims, I will bring in. And they shall know the land which you have despised. See, God purposed in his heart that something was going to happen for Israel. And regardless of how Israel, the adults, the leadership, and all those people behaved, God still was going to stick to his promise to bring them into the promised land. And here's what I want you to see in this story today, is that God gave Israel land to occupy. And he has given us land to occupy as well, and that's this city. God was, is, and will be doing things far, far differently than we can see or imagine because his ways are above our ways. And the 10 spies couldn't see what he wanted them to see. So they did not see themselves as able to occupy the land. I feel as believers sometimes we grieve the Father in the same way by not knowing how to handle what he's given us. The 10 spies saw themselves as grasshoppers, which is a serious identity issue. I don't know if you caught on to that. That's a problem. And I think many believers today see themselves the same way. I'm not good enough at prayer or speaking to people about my faith, or I'm too shy and nervous to tell people how Jesus has changed my life. We had a special speaker. Wednesday night was our first, what we've called a discipleship meeting. We met out here in the coffee bar area for about an hour and a half. It was really good. We shared a little something to eat together. And then we had a special speaker in from out of town. His name is Joshua. And Joshua was telling us about a store that he and his wife run in Minnesota. CHAP? Is that it? Caring, Helping, and Providing? You didn't think I paid attention. Caring, Helping, and Providing. And he told us about how they were seeing prayers answered in this store. They were seeing miracles, conversions, and all these things happening. And I said, I wanted to ask him, Joshua, how is that happening? I knew the answer, but I wanted everybody there to hear it. It's happening because they made themselves available for God to do things that God does. They step out in faith. You know, Floyd told me We talked Monday afternoon that he had gone to the prayer tent. I don't know if anybody's been to the prayer tent over at the fair. He told me a little bit about his evening there over the weekend and how powerful it was. And while he was there, I said, you guys been to the fair? I haven't been to the Tannenau Fair, but I went to the county fair when I grew up, and it descended as the evening or day wore on. It descended into drunken fights and carrying on like that because it's out in the country, and it just wasn't a place for me. But he said, so you kind of see this, right? You visualize it. People just walking around doing their thing, and as people would go by the tent, something the Lord stirred up in Floyd was, hey, I can't sit inside the tent. I need to go outside and engage people. It's important because they're not going to come in here. They're going to go by until they know what's inside. And as God, the way God works is, he's already been stirring something up in the hearts and minds of his children, those who know Jesus and those who do not. He's already at work. Remember, Floyd said that last week, that we are both to be and to do as believers. And then what happens once somebody steps out there is God takes what he has put in place in his people who are willing to step into their destiny as followers of Jesus Christ to put it to work to bring about a conversion for somebody. And that's where the nitty-gritty of grasshopper versus giants meets the road. Okay? When we step out in faith, when we're willing to step out in faith and exercise what God has called us to do, we're getting to the place in the road where it's a nitty-gritty between being a grasshopper or being a giant. Am I willing to step in or do I want to step out? Does that a little clearer? Okay. And Floyd started telling me what's happening. They begin to engage people a little bit. And as the evening progressed, more and more people came into contact with the person of Jesus through the people who were willing to step outside the confines of the building or the tent. And let's face it, sometimes the walls of this building are like confinement because we keep what we've been given in here. But they stepped outside and they said, hey, can I tell you that the kingdom of heaven is at hand? This is what Jesus did, right? I'm not going to get in trouble with anybody because I cleared this with Floyd. He's the final arbiter of everything. It's been my belief that a religious spirit has hung over the church and over this city for a long, long time. And that spirit is intended to keep us within these walls. And the enemy of our souls has been incredible at using it. Once we go outside, we start to take back land. And we have a role to play as believers. And that role is not limited to Sunday mornings for 60 or 90 minutes. And everybody says, well, this church over there or that church over there. Look, I don't care if that church over there has 15 services on Sunday or that church down in North Pole has great programs. None of those things matter. I asked this question Wednesday night. Locate for me in Scripture where Jesus told his followers to create men's ministry and women's ministry separate and apart from one another. To create a children's ministry to keep the kids away from their parents when the gospel is being preached on Sunday mornings. There's no senior citizens ministries called for in Scripture. Fellowship's important. Don't misunderstand. This is fellowship. And fellowship goes outside the walls. Jesus' command was simple. Go to the lost and the hurting. And as you go, he gave us some things to do. Let's take a look at it. Matthew 10. But go, rather, to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. We have a job to do, right? To go to the lost and the hurting. And when you go home today, I've got a job for you. I want you to pay attention as you drive home today or as you're driving through town on your way to or from work or groceries or childcare, wherever you're going. See if you don't see some lost and hurting walk in the streets. There are so many that are lost and hurting. And we often pass them by, not taking into consideration what we've been commanded to do. And we need to be giants in this role and not grasshoppers. Listen, when we get to heaven, and I don't know this for sure, right? I haven't been there, thankfully, yet. But I did some research for a professor who was writing a book at seminary about near-death experiences. And all of these people that were Christians all over the world had the same response about what this near-death experience looked like. And it was a movie of their life, every single frame in an instant. They watched it with Jesus. But God's going to look at what we did, and he's not going to pat me on the head because I had perfect attendance at men's breakfast. The word says your work will be tested by fire. And he's going to have a conversation with us, right? He's going to ask some simple questions. What did you do with my son? I don't know these for sure, but I'm just kind of thinking ahead. What did you do with the gifts that I gave you? I intend to tell him, I loved your son, just like I'm sure all of you are. And I'm going to answer him honestly. Papa, I did what you asked me to do. I went. I shared Jesus' name and what he's done in my life. I prayed for others to come to know him. I loved those who were lost and hurting into their own relationship with your son. And I did my best to be the giant you created me to be. There's another side of that, though. It could sound like, well, you know, Papa, I wasn't very good at praying and telling people how your son changed my life. And so I sat back and I waited for everybody at the church to do that. But I was always at men's breakfast and or women's Bible study. And I was in church most Sundays. And I gave a little piece of money. Which report do you want to give? I want to give that first one. You know, it doesn't matter, friends. God is loving and he's merciful, and he's going to allow us into heaven because we loved his son. That's what the word says. And the reality is, when we get there and we stand in judgment for the fruit of our lives, that's when the rubber meets the road. And I intend to spend the rest of my life bearing as much fruit as I can. And I want you to join me in that. We all have a part to play. You know, sometimes we overlook the idea that God's at work long before we go out in our minds to do something. How many of you do that? You know, you feel in your heart like, oh, you know, I should go talk to that young couple over there. They're new. I've not seen them before. Maybe I should go do something. And then we go and do it. And why does it happen? Why is it when I get there, I know exactly what to say to them? Because God has been at work. Remember, I told you a couple Sundays ago in Ephesians, I have set aside works for you to do from the foundation of the world that you should walk in them. They're there for us to step into that new thing that God has for us. And he's going to be busy putting the anointing and the gifting and the words and everything I need. So when I get to that couple, I know exactly what to say. How many of you have been in that situation? Where God said, hey, I want you to, they point somebody out to you. Man, it's like somebody put a highlighter on them. And you walk right over there, and all of a sudden, boom, these words come out of your mouth. That's God at work. See, he's busy. He knows that that work is set aside for me to get to, correct? We agree on this? If you disagree, go sit over there. I'm just kidding. We agree that that work is set aside for us, and we're going to walk into it. But while we're on our way, and he knows that all these things are going to happen, what is God busy doing? He's watching over the watch of those who watch for him. It's a circle. Do you see it? So when I get there to talk to that person, it's already ready. I've got the words, the gifting, the anointing, the whole nine yards. And Floyd and I were chatting this morning, and I said, I'm going to bite this rhyme from you because I really like it. That means copy what he said, for those of you that aren't hip. He said, imagine you purpose when you get up in the morning to drive to Fred Meyer. So you get in the car and you're driving to Fred Meyer and you come out of Esther and you come into town and you go past all the stores and you get to Fred Meyer, you park, you get out of your car, you walk up to the door, and when you get to the door, it opens. Right? But it doesn't open when you get in the car at home. It's open when you get there. And God's working the same way. Isn't that an amazing illustration? I got to give him credit for it. It's a great illustration, is it? Does it make this make more sense to you now? Good. But some of you, and I'm watching you, you decide, well, I'm going to wait until I'm more familiar with Scripture, or I've got more of Christ's character in my life, or whatever grasshopper excuse you have for yourself. That's disobedience. We don't want that in our lives. And that's born out of that religious mindset that I talked to you about earlier. Consider the actions of the disciples. You know, Floyd paid me a compliment the other day. I had to think about it on the way home, see if I thought it was a compliment. He said, you probably know more about what's in the Bible than the disciples did. Like, well, they didn't have a Bible, but they had some scrolls and some writings, but they were carpenters, masons, fishermen. Maybe they couldn't read, so somebody would have to recite that to them. And we have it all at our disposal, right? You can pop open your phone, and you have more in your hand than the disciples had. But what the disciples have, they followed the leadership and the example set for them by their Messiah, and it made all the difference in the world. Do you see? The book is great. The book in itself does not solve the problem. The book just gives us direction. The first time I went to pray for somebody or to walk up to a total stranger, I was terrified. I had no idea what to say. I wasn't well-versed in Scripture. I didn't know any cool prayers. I had zero anointing in my life. But I took a chance that I could listen to the heart cry of someone who was struggling in this world, who needed to have a word from them that would reassure them and affirm them that everything was going to be okay. God allowed me to speak some peace into their situation. And what did I do then? I got back out of the way and I let God be God. That's not our job. We're never going to be God, so don't try. All we're called upon to do is as Jesus commanded, go, that's action verb, go. In other words, get out of your seat, get out of your comfortable routine in life, and go. There are people out there who need to hear from you. Your friends, family, coworkers, if they're not friends already. They all need to hear the name of Jesus. And he says, go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and as you go, preach. Can anybody preach? Absolutely. Can you share your testimony about what Jesus has done in your life? Absolutely. But it comes down to, am I going to be a grasshopper or am I going to be a giant? To speak boldly requires risk-taking and being willing to tell people that you love Jesus. I don't care who I speak to, I tell them that I love Jesus. You know, the cross is there for a purpose. That cross illustrates something as believers to us, doesn't it? But sometimes I think we get misaligned with what the cross wants us to do. Paul spent an entire book of Romans telling people how to work from the cross. It says in Romans 6:11, reckon yourself. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I don't want to deal with the first half about sin. I want to talk about being alive to God in Christ Jesus. And the word reckon here points to our need to change our thinking. Paul spent the entire book of Romans talking about changing your thinking, and he summed it up in 12:2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's all about changing my heart and my mind. The battlefield, friends, is in our hearts and in our minds. Am I willing to step out there and tell somebody and confess my love for Jesus? And then watch what happens. How many of you have a situation where Jesus stepped into your life and it's changed you forever? I was a bully, a mean person, vindictive, competitive, bitter. Did I say bitter? Because I was bitter if I said it twice. Until I met Jesus. And I asked him to change the way I see the world. And he did. Floyd made the comment the other night that I could go anywhere and talk to anybody about anything. It's true. I can. Wasn't always like that. It wasn't always like that. It came about through pursuing encounters with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit so I could be prepared to play my part advancing the kingdom of heaven. That's incumbent upon us as believers to step into that. And at the end of service today, I'm going to share a little bit of a formula I've used from the time I became a believer until now. See, I passionately desire life-changing encounters with God. That's the only way things are going to be different in my life, is to pursue the new. Hunger for more. That's what we sang in that Holy Spirit song. I want to hunger for more. I can't be content with where I am. I seek to run into divine appointments. If God's moving over in Esther, I'm going to be in Esther where God is moving. If he goes to North Pole, guess where I'm going? I'm going to North Pole. We have to be where he's busy. We have to be participating with him. And the truth is, I don't care who gets credit or who has press clippings. None of that matters. The advancement of the kingdom of heaven is the only thing every believer should desire to see happen. That's not the only thing, but I want to say one of the most important things. We must desire to see that happen. And pursuing encounters should be the standard bearer for every believer. Can we agree? Right? I pursue him because he first pursued me. He showed me what it means to love someone who we didn't feel worthy of being loved. I didn't, because I was a hateful person. I still am towards Michigan football. For you guys don't know, I'm an Ohio State fan. Inject a little humor in that. You know, if the average Christian, what'd you say? Bucks? That's what I thought you said. If the average Christian is content with an average, normal life, I gotta go against the grain. I got to be the fish that swims against that stream, right? I can't allow average into my relationship with him. And I'm trying to encourage you not to either. And I hear a lot of people complain about this or that. You know, I prayed for all these things and it didn't happen. Or this is happening. You know, I've had people praying for me for physical healing for a good while, but I'm dealing with some physical limitations. I'm not complaining about them. Because I know that I'm going to overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. When he's ready, he'll be God and take care of it. And I want more of him. And my prayer has been that you would want more of him as well. That we can come alongside one another and take what he has revealed to us and sowed into our lives and then pour it out on the lost and the hurting in this city. We all have a role to play in this, friends, and the time is upon us to break down these religious strongholds that have hung over this city and this church for far, far too long. The problem is we need to reshape the way we think. And as I was putting this together this week, I was reminded of a friend of mine back in Dayton, and I'm going to share a little bit of a story with you that I hope illustrates what I'm talking about. My friend Larry was raised up in a denominational church, which is fine. Many of us are, or were. And he was at our non-denominational church where Julie and I were fellowshipping. And he was at a table one Saturday with his wife, and a woman named Jane was sitting at the table talking about a conference she had been to. And she said after the worship session, the first morning, she goes, it was powerful worship. And she goes, I sat down and I opened my Bible and I looked at my hands and they were covered in gold dust. And she was talking about how amazing it was. My friend Larry just kind of went, that's crazy talk, lady. And she continued on about it. Pretty soon my friend Larry is sitting there, and God was paying attention to this too. He's like, Larry, let me show you something. And Larry looks down at his hands, and they're covered. And he slams his hands in his pockets, and he rushes outside. If I could get down on my hands and knees, I'd show you how he behaved. But we'd have to spend a half hour waiting for the EMTs. And he's in the dirt, rubbing his hands just as hard as he can. He looks at him, it won't come off. He goes in the men's room, washes his hands, won't come off. He doesn't know what to do. And Julie and I followed them down the road on the way home after service Saturday night. Larry's wife is driving, and Larry's got that right hand out the window, looking at it because the sun's hitting down on it. He's amazed by what he saw. And I laughed. You know, it's like God. God brings out the gold in this, doesn't he? He wants the gold to come out of us, to arise out of each and every one of us. And that's part of my responsibility, Floyd's responsibility, your responsibility as believers to bring out the gold in the people around you. I told you this not because I wanted you to hear about this awesome manifestation of God's presence, but the fact that Larry is representative of many in the church today. So many people in church today do not have the framework or structure to put something like this into. So what do we do with it? We dismiss it. If it's uncomfortable, we dismiss it. And that limiter or governor, if you want to call it that, hinders our development. We stay grasshoppers that way. I mentored Larry for several years. We were hunting buddies and all those kind of things. We would deer hunt together, and every morning when we went out together, we'd get to the top of the trailhead where we're going to split and go to our stands, and I'd say, hey, Larry, let's pray. And we'd pray, and off we'd go, just simple stuff, and there was safety, can we see some deer, that kind of thing. Just fun things to keep us, you know, in a good spot. And for 3 years, I was the only one that prayed. And every time I say, hey, Larry, you want to pray this morning? No, you go. Larry chose, no matter how much work we put in together, Larry chose to remain a grasshopper. Does this make sense to you? Are you understanding what I'm saying? Weekly meetings, Sunday mornings, seminars, all those things, they're not going to bring about the transformation in you or the transformation the city needs. Fellowshipping is important. Don't misunderstand, but it takes a boldness on the part of the believer to look at the land that's out there for us and to see themselves as a giant to step into the land. That's the call upon us today. You're not grasshoppers. None of you. You're giants. And you have land that is yours to possess and occupy, and that land is this city, and our job is to reach the lost and hurting for Jesus Christ. Two people can't do it. The 10 people, 20 people, I think there was 25 at the Wednesday night discipleship class. We can't do it on our own. We need everybody. You know, I told them Wednesday night, if you look in Scripture, I'll challenge anybody to show me in Scripture where Jesus healed somebody in the temple, or where you read about somebody receiving their salvation in the temple. I've racked my brain and I can't find it. And that should be a really, really good indication that the battlefield is out there. It's not in here. I'm not suggesting, friends, that we stop fellowshipping or anything like that, or that we stop attending church. Far from it. What I am suggesting to you is that once you've been filled up here on Sunday morning, and once you've filled yourself in the secret place at home, and trust me, that's your job, you need to be feeding yourself. You feed yourself in the Word and in the secret place and in meditation and worship. Then you take what you've received in that time with Him and you go pour it out. I know some of you do. Some of you do it all the time. Remember, Jesus healed everybody who came to Him. Zacchaeus received his salvation because he climbed a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus on the way. What's that say? Jesus was walking the streets, the highways and the byways, looking for people to tell the good news. Mark's gospel starts out in the Greek, arche euangelio tou Jesu Christou, huios tou Theou, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, Son of God. What we're talking about doing is good news. Is sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. There's so much work to do, friends. So much work to do. I said at the beginning, remember I said this, that David said, the people shall perish for lack of vision. Vision is important, and I'm going to share a little bit of a vision with you for this church in this season we're in right now. In the coming weeks and months, we're going to begin doing just what I'm talking about Jesus doing. We're going to start going out to the city. Don't panic. Don't run for the exits. It's going to be okay. We'll start slow. We'll start with low impact stuff. And I can tell you, because now I can go anywhere and talk to anybody about the good news, I can lay hands on the sick, preach the gospel, doesn't matter. That all takes place today because, like weight training, I began doing it day after day after day. Repetition, 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 practice until it becomes routine. That's how it happens in our lives, friends. How many of you have been out to dinner in Fairbanks or anywhere? You're enjoying your dinner, and it's time the check comes, and the young man or woman that's waiting the table comes up and says, hey, a stranger paid for your meal. How many of you had that happen? Yeah. Well, I know you did because we were together. Probably a little over a year ago, I think, we were at Brewster's up on Airport Way, just enjoying the evening, having dinner together. And the young lady brought us our ticket at the end of the night, and she sat it down, and she goes, oh, by the way, somebody took care of your meal. Huh? We started looking around. Who do we know here? We didn't know anybody. But somebody had felt it on their heart to pay for our meal because God had stirred something up in them. It's a low-impact way to reach out and share the love of God, isn't it? Can you do that? Could you pray for somebody's coffee or their meal inconspicuously and then watch how they walk out feeling blessed? That's what I'm talking about. In the coming weeks, we're going to have some little business cards that on the front of them says information about Friends Church, where we are, this, you know, address, those kind of things. And on the back, it's just going to be a simple message. Hey, your dinner's on us. Your coffee's on us, whatever it is. I just wanted to show you God's love in a practical way. It's an easy byline to remember, isn't it? Anybody can speak this. And you put it in the hands of a stranger. And what's going to happen is the person that having their meal receives that, they're going to be blessed. They're going to want to know who, why. Why would you do that? That's the question. Why would you buy my coffee? Because I wanted to show you God's love. Is that okay? But you're going to get the person that took the ticket, the waiter or the waitress, they're going to be impacted. Maybe somebody back in the back is going to see this and they're going to be impacted. We're going to slowly build up our outreach muscle, friends, to the point where we're ready to go to the next level, whatever that looks like for you. And if you want to learn and grow, but you're skeptical, you're not confident, I will spend hours and hours working with you if you want to do it until you're ready and you feel confident that you can go and do what I'm talking about doing without somebody prompting you, till it becomes routine for you. That's the gift that other people gave me. They poured that into me. I remember here at Friends, I think it was 2017 or 18, the young adults group decided they were going to do an outreach at the food bank. I asked if I could come with them. So we went down to the food bank on a Saturday morning and packed boxes of groceries, and some of us carried the groceries out to people's cars and, you know, just got a chance to talk to them. Hey, anything I could pray for you, with you about, yada, yada. And people started opening up. Yeah, man, I'm struggling. I've got financial issues. I've got this issue, relation, whatever it was. Can I pray with you? Just say a simple prayer and stand back and let God be God. You know, I told you a while back that I believe we're going to get to heaven and Jesus is going to say, hey, let me show you the people that are here today because of you. Right? And it's very hard for me to talk about that sometimes because I'm a kind of an emotional fella. You might not be able to know that. But that's hard words to speak. To stand before God and his son says, hey, these people here are here today because of you. That's powerful. Those young adults brought their kids. They were having time to minister to people. I got to minister to some kids who were there because they had community service, who were down on themselves. The city was down on them. The system was down on them. I'm like, listen, man, God's not down on you. He's down with you because he loves you and he wants to see you succeed in life. You know, friends, whatever gifting or anointing you possess, you have to give it away. You have to give it away. That's the only way we get to keep it. And each one of us plays a part in the transformation of this city. Each one of us is a small cog in the mighty wheel of the hand of God as he comes in to reveal himself and his nature in this city. The whole idea is for us to give God an opportunity to show his extravagant love for the people of this city. To blast through all the noise, all the stuff that's trying to keep us away. And we have a part in how that plays out and how we grow as a church, how we grow as believers, and how we grow as a community. Please understand, hear this loudly and clearly. This is not about putting more feet in the seats. It's not about that. It's about people coming to know the person of Jesus Christ so that they spend eternity in heaven with us. What if nothing happens? I've had that question asked. What if I pray for somebody and nothing happens? It's a fair question. Sometimes we pray and nothing happens. I don't have all the answers on that one. All I know is I'm not God. And all I know is that God has asked me to pray and to do my part. But the point is, if we do all these things, if we preach, teach, witness, and nothing happens, we go back to the drawing board. And the drawing board is time on our knees, praying, asking, seeking God. You know, for decades, I've told you on several occasions, powerlessness is not an excuse. In fact, it's inexcusable to live a life as a powerless believer. And for decades, churches have created doctrines to justify their lack of power instead of crying out to God to change the situation. Entire theologies have emerged to cause us to be afraid of the person of the Holy Spirit because we cannot understand it, we cannot control it. So we don't want it. When we sang that song this morning, what a beautiful name it is. Do you listen to that in your heart as you sing it? Do you take it in? Especially the end. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. The Bible says his is a name above all names. And when I speak his name into a situation, he comes into that situation. When his name is spoken, friends, strongholds are broken down, blind eyes and deaf ears are opened, and the dead are called to life. I want to be a part of that. I don't know about you. I want that in my life. And his word must go forth with a mindset wrapped around that thought, that his name means power. A powerless word is a letter. That's what Paul says. But not the Spirit. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It's up on the screen there. It says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Of all the things I've talked about this morning, friends, that can happen when you are sharing the name of Jesus with someone is that they have a conversion. And conversions, friends, I think is one of the greatest miracles of all. It ranks up there with healings, the healings, signs, and wonders. And all these things are available to the believer, to each and every one of us. I don't care if this is only your second or third week in church. If you're in Doug's Tuesday night group, you're a new believer, it's available to you. You don't have to be gray-haired and long in the tooth to work in power. You pursue it. You pursue God, and you allow him to put those things into your life. All this is available to you, friends. So, you still with me? I haven't made you angry, have I? Pretty good. I've only got about another 45 minutes, and we'll wrap it up, Floyd. I want to share five things with you this morning to be a takeaway, so we can begin to build this spiritual muscle together. And they're important. They're low impact, which at my age, that's important. Number one is pursue time alone in the secret place. It's invaluable. Wherever and whenever you can, sit down with him. Listen for his heart for you. What you hear, write it down. Right? If it's a negative thought, it's not from him. If you hear somebody say, well, you know, in a couple years when you're better, it's not from him. Write it down. Ponder it. Pray about it. Ask him for clarity if necessary. But above all, pursue him. Number two, and this may take a little explanation, learn to position yourself between the Father and the Son. Right? What do I mean by that? The incredible love relationship between Jesus and the Father is the perfect example for all believers to follow. And when we put ourselves in the midst of that union, we are in the ideal place to be. If our hearts are closed to both of them, we're going to find ourselves learning and growing at an exponential rate. And you talk about building spiritual muscle. That's going to be the place where that takes place. Doubts and fears will be cast aside. New levels of trust and anointing and gifting are going to emerge. And you're going to begin to see things the way God wants you to see them. Number three, this one's hard for some people, is to share what Christ has done in, with, and for you. Share that with a stranger or someone who is dealing with some issues. Maybe you have a family member that doesn't know the Lord. Start there. Your kindness, sharing the name of Jesus, is what's going to bring about a change in that person's life, and it's going to usher in a new level of his kingdom that didn't previously exist and that that person has never known. Number four, sow seeds. Sow seeds. When you cast seeds of hope, you're taking land from the enemy. Little by little, you begin to push back the darkness, and his light comes greater and greater into the situation. It's easy. It takes a little change out of your pocket. But sow seeds. Even just use words. Hey, man, you're struggling with some stuff right now? Look, I know we're buddies, and you know we work on these crews together late into the evening. Can I tell you about somebody I know? His name is Jesus. And he's hooked me up. Can you do that? Do you have it within you to do that? Just to share his name? Hey, I'm praying for you. And then number five, refuse to stay where you are. Hunger for more. That's what she's saying in the song, for more. Don't be content where you are. Press in for more. And as we hunger and thirst for more, he's going to give us the strength we need, and he's going to fill us to overflowing with his heart and his desire for us in our lives. Reject the theology that says you are to sit quietly and remain a new believer or a grasshopper all your life. Calling you to action this morning. Is that pretty clear? You getting that? Indeed. Friends, I want to see you emerge as the giants God's created you to be. I said this a couple of weeks ago. You have incredible power, incredible potential, and it's time for you to take that power and that potential and put it to work for the Lord. The enemy is worried. I'm going to tell you this. The enemy is worried that the church is going to begin to wake up to the reality of that power and prove him to be the grasshopper that he is. I remember the first time we were getting ready to go to Africa, and our pastor friend there, Felitu is his name, he was telling us about the enemy because he said there's a lot of demonic possession there. He said, Felitu, what happens if people start to manifest? He just laughed. Ha, 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 ha. The enemy is a mouse with a megaphone. We got to remember that. He's a mouse with a megaphone. Our God is so much more powerful. His voice shakes the heavens. Doesn't say anything about the enemy's voice doing that, does it? No. So that's it, friends. Listen to the Lord's voice. You know it. You know when you've heard his voice, right? Says in John 10, my sheep will know my voice. And today I'm going to ask you, cry out to him for more. Hunger for more. Don't settle for the average or the mundane, because he's doing so much in the background waiting for his giants to emerge as he's called them to himself to awaken to life. Amen? Let's pray. And I'm just going to say this, if you need prayer about something, you can come down, come front after service. We'd love to pray for you. God, that as your word resonates in our hearts today, as you're calling us to become the giants that you created us to be, I want to pray this morning, Father, for greater levels of gifting, anointing, blessing. I want to pray for hearts and minds this morning to understand that the battlefield they face is nothing. I'm praying for boldness this morning, boldness in the heart and in the spirit of the believers here today, people who are hungry, who want to be a part of what we've talked about this morning, that you pour into them that gifting, that boldness, the courage. Father, I believe that even today there are people in this room who are going to speak the name of Jesus to someone, and a seed is going to be sown, and people are going to come to know the Lord Jesus through that action. God, there's so much that needs to be done. And those of us who are here gathered this morning, Lord, we want to be a part of what you're doing in this city, part of what you're doing in this church. God, I ask for favor for people when they go out and speak to folks. I ask for open doors for them to walk into. Doors they never thought would open, God, you can open. Pray for hearts to be won for for the kingdom, even today, Lord. Divine appointments for everybody in Friends Church this morning. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Have a wonderful day. It's good to see you all this morning.